Good morning, everybody. Kyle, I just realized I never got a check on this. I'm sorry, so I'll ramble a little bit to give you a minute. How are we all doing? Joel's good, okay. Okay, how are we all doing? Good. Good, good. How many of you have been wondering leading up to this week, who in the world is going to preach our annual July 4th message? Raise your hand if you've been wondering that. Nobody's been wondering that? Okay, we got a couple honest people, all right. We got to pray. Nobody? Okay, never mind. I wondered myself. When I think about my dad and I think about all the things that come with his personality, I thought, who in the world can do this message and do it any justice? He said he wanted me to do it, much to my surprise. So here I am. And while I am my father's son, I'm obviously not my father. And one thing for sure, you will never hear me refer to myself as a flaming patriot. Though I am a patriot and I do love this country. You know, flaming hot Cheetos is about as far as I go with that, and I don't even like those. So we'll leave that alone. But one of the things that he did instill in me is an absolute obsession with history. It has informed everything that I have ever done, from my love of the Bible to my love of country and even some of my children's names. I don't know if it was my early exposure to Indiana Jones or my early exposure to miniseries like Roots or North and South or movies like Gettysburg. I just became obsessed with this idea of history, that these were real people at real places dealing with real things at a particular point in time, and that we still talk about it today. And if you think about this, this is in everything we do. Remembering, looking back, seeing what's happened before, seeing what's led us to where we are now. Everything from our history as a nation, to our history personally, to our relationship with Christ. It's this progression of looking back to see where we've come from and where we've been. Now I'm going to tell you this. Obviously, we're not perfect, those of us who preach here, but we will always do our best to tell you the truth. And the fact of the matter is, absolute truth is only absolute because it originates from the original. In everything, but especially when we're talking about spiritually, the original being God himself. So, I want you all to say something with me today on this Independence Weekend. Say this: I am a Christian. Say, I am an American. You can insert your own country if that doesn't apply to you today. In that order. We'll get back to that. But first of all, I want to talk specifically about my heart for America. Like I said, history has been my obsession. And while I love world history, American history has been particularly my obsession because I love it here. This is my home. This is where I live. I want God to bless every nation in the world that is following him, that is listening to his voice. But this is where I live. Just like this is my church. And I care about what's happening at Grace, and I care about what's happening at West Hill. But I mostly care about what's happening here. This is family. You are my people. And the same is true there. I remember, let me give you a little context here. Every 4 years, we just came through one, but every 4 years, we have what's called the General Assembly of the Church of the Nazarene. And people come from all over the world to gather and do the business of the church. There's voting and polity, but we worship together. And every shade of skin color and every language you can imagine is in that place, gathered at the convention center in Indianapolis, coming together as the family of God to lift up and worship him. It is one of my favorite things that I've ever been a part of in my life. But a couple of years ago, we were at one. It was the first one my wife had gone to. And I was leading worship in a prayer room. And there was a particular session where they wanted us to find, they had this huge world map on the ground. And they wanted us to find a particular place. And they said, you know, whatever nation your heart is yearning for, yearning to pray for, yearning to cry out for, I want you to go to that spot. I want you to put your hands on it. And I want you to cry out for that nation. So, being that the United States is a little more spread out, I went to that map and I knelt down on the continental United States and I reached up here to Alaska and I stuck a foot on Hawaii and I began to pray. And suddenly, from deep inside me, a place that I've never really ever touched, a weeping and a wailing and just a grief and a heaviness came over my soul, and I just began to do the loudest, ugliest cry you have ever seen. And I am not a crier, for those of you who don't know me well. I am not. Basically, my rules for crying are if something particularly good happens with my children, if my father or my brother cry, I'm going to cry. But other than that, there's not a whole lot. But weeping and wailing, and I remember sitting up after it was all said and done, and I looked up at Kayla sitting on the front row, and she's just wide-eyed staring at me, her mouth open a little, surprised to see me do this. Again, this is not normal for me. And it was that moment that I realized that God has put something specifically in my heart for this place, for this country, for this nation. And I remember all the time as a kid growing up, the big tagline for every ministry, every youth thing that you saw, oh, you're going to go to the nations, you're going to go to the nations, you're going to go to the nations. I'm like, I don't want to. Like, that's not a thing for me. Lord bless you if you're going, but that's not a thing for me. And I always felt guilty for that until this moment when God revealed to me, this is where I have put you and this is why. This is where your heart is for. This is our home. This is where we live. We need to care about this. And so in all of that, I'm not going to give you the detailed history lesson that my dad did the last time he did this series. I'm going to talk about a few more out there things, I guess, because I don't think we need that history lesson again. But I will say this. I am probably going to offend all of you a little today. Whatever political spectrum you are on, left, right, middle, I don't knows, I don't cares, whatever you are, I will probably offend you a little today. And that is okay. The amazing thing about offense is nothing happens. Like seriously, what happens if you get offended? If I get offended? Nothing happens. Offense is good for us every once in a while. In the same way that a child wrestling with their father is a good thing. You learn what hurts and what doesn't and what matters and what doesn't. We're not just sensitive. You know, I remember I tussled with a kid once. I was just playing around and I kind of put him down on the couch and they got real wide-eyed and scared. I'm like, oh, you've never been wrestled with before by an adult. Offense is just a little trigger to show us what is and is not actually scary and is not actually harmful in our lives. So if you get a little offended today, I'm not sorry. If you get a little offended, it means we got to do some internal thinking and talking and reflecting, okay? I'm not going to be intentionally offensive, but I will offend somebody today. So there you go. Let's get that out of the way. So the first thing I'm going to do is tell you this. I am going to get to Scripture. I have a very large section of Scripture I'm going to get to at the end. So don't be sitting here checking off boxes like, when's you going to get to it? It's coming. It's coming. But the first thing I want to talk about is understanding the founders of our country. The men who did the work, who wrote the documents, who bled and died so that we could be standing here today. And there's a really big misconception about these men on the left and the right, and it's one of two opinions. Either we think they were divine, that they just had these like they were the Marvel universe of the 18th century, that they just were these superhuman, super powerful. They did all these things, and oh, wasn't it all just perfect and great? We think they're divine, or we think they're devils. We talk about all the ways that they should have done this, should have done that. We gauge their responses and thoughts and opinions based on our 21st century mentalities. Forget the fact that this was 240 years ago. But the fact of the matter is, they weren't either. They were men. They were men with sin and flaws and contradictions and hypocrisies and brilliance and deep thinkers and philosophies. They were just men like you and I. And for those of you who do want to lay our 21st century sensibilities over all of these men, let me ask you this question. If I were to go back through your Facebook, Twitter, or whatever the current thing is, feed, from 10 years ago, how would that hold up to what you think, who you are, and the opinion you would carry now? I don't want you to answer that out loud, but think about it. That was just 10 years ago. For crying out loud, most of our COVID opinions from 3 years ago are not the same as they were when it happened. And yet, we look back at this time and we think we can just nail exactly what these people were. They weren't gods. They weren't devils. They were just men. And I have to say this. If you want to learn about who these guys are, who they were, what their opinions were, stop scouring the internet for it. Stop reading books that you know are partisan. The biggest ways that these people communicated was through what? And we have almost all of them. They communicated through letters. There are biographies of these people. Go to the National Archives. You can read their thoughts in their own words, both from private correspondence and the public things that they were all about, the policies that they had. You can find it all. And I gotta tell you, if you'd have told me in 1995 that the internet was gonna make us dumber as a people, I wouldn't have believed it. But it has. Not because we're stupid, but because it's made us lazy. We go out and we find a meme, or we find somebody on the right that's ranting, or we find somebody on the left that's ranting, and they're like, yeah, that's what I think, so that's what it was. No! Go find the actual thing. It's out there. If you need some resources, I'd be glad to tell you some. You know, there's a great a book series, not a book series, but there's a great book that I'm currently reading through that's about John Adams, that's called John Adams, appropriately enough. And it's by a man named David McCullough. Great book. He also wrote one called 1776, which I have not read yet, but I've heard great things. And it's mostly just these people's letters, their correspondence, their daily life, telling about the things they believed and what they were doing in these moments in time. And I'm going to just go ahead and address the elephant in the room because everybody gets uncomfortable with this when we talk about the founders. If you want to know the opinion of slavery, race relations, and their opinion on women, you can find that too. Because what they thought was common. What they thought was not shameful at the time. And I'll tell you this, they talked about things like slavery in the same way that we have debates about abortion today. Culturally, it was very similar. And no, I'm not going to go on an abortion rant. Just keep breathing. It's okay. But think about that. We talk about this openly. We talk about it on the internet. We talk about it. We talk about it everywhere because it is the debate of the day. For some people, it's a moral debate. For some people, it's just a political debate. For some people, it's about a woman. For some people, it's about the baby. It's all over the place. And you have this huge swath of people in the middle who just don't want to have an opinion at all. They don't really want to talk about it. They don't want to face it. Just, you know, that's not my problem. That's not my thing. I'm just gonna step back. And I know we like to fancy ourselves that we would have all been abolitionists back in the day. I got to tell you, statistically, you'd mostly have been that middle where you're going, I don't want to deal with this. So my only reason to bring that up is because it makes us just as uncomfortable today to talk about that as slavery would have been talked about back then, or the rights of women back then. I'm not making an excuse for anything. I'm saying we have to think about what people were dealing with in the moment they were dealing with it. It's very easy to armchair quarterback everything from today. It's very easy. I promise that's the most uncomfortable you're going to be today. So everybody take a breath. We're okay. Consider how you would fare under the kind of scrutiny that these people had. And for those of you who expect perfection from the people that you look up to, let me burst a couple more bubbles. Moses was a great man, but he was still just a man. And he was a man who was a coward and a man who flat out refused several times to do what God told him to do. And he had an anger problem to the point where he killed somebody. To the point where his anger problem, even later in life, kept him out of the promised land. Moses was not perfect. King David, one of the greatest men, greatest worshipers, greatest whatever you want to talk about. If you grew up in the 90s, everything was all about King David because of the worship revolution. Oh, yeah. And he did a lot of great things. But the man, at best, seduced a close friend's wife. By today's standards, probably raped her and then murdered him. I could go on. Dr. Martin Luther King, because of my love of history, a man I have also been obsessed with, I could tell you about anything about that man's life. He plagiarized his doctoral thesis, most of it. And the man was a known philanderer that cheated on his wife throughout his whole process in the civil rights movement. Does that negate the good that he did? Does that negate what we saw in David, what we have from Moses? Do these things all get canceled out because we're human and imperfect? And these people were too. Is the grace of God that short and that lacking? Just want to give us some perspective today. The biggest thing that you'll hear me knock the founders for is something that we're going to talk about as we go on here. Is that for the sake of expediency, for the sake of coming together as a nation, they made a compromise. And they chose to make the moral political on the issue of slavery. If you read the writings of our founders, even some of them who were plantation owners, were slave owners, there was a very strong understanding that there was something wrong with this, what was called then, institution. You see it from Jefferson. You see it from Washington. You very, very strongly see it from John Adams, who, by the way, is my favorite founding father. And it's really interesting. If you read the first draft of the Declaration of Independence, you will hear one of the most damning swings ever taken at the institution of slavery, written by Thomas Jefferson himself. And in the name of expediency and political philanderings and all these things, John Adams and Benjamin Franklin, both staunch abolitionist type guys, as part of the Gang of Five that wrote that whole thing, looked at each other and said, man, I just don't think we're going to be able to come together and unite if we do this. And they made Thomas Jefferson take it out. There was a knowledge that this was a moral issue. And yet they just decided, no, we're just going to go ahead and turn this into a political issue. Just put that in your pocket. We'll talk about that again later. One of the things that did mark this, and this is one of the reasons why I will give some obvious flack to the founding fathers, is that there was a very strong understanding from these men that they were about to take on the most powerful nation that the world had ever seen. They were going to fight a war that they had no business fighting. They were going to stand up to a power that they had no business even thinking about standing up to. And as so often happens with people, they realized the only way they were going to have any hope was if they relied on God. Once again, I'm not saying that every single one of our founders was a Christian. I'm not saying that every single one of them lived out the principles they should. I'm not saying that every one of them even believed in God, because that's not true. But the majority of them had enough of an understanding to know that they weren't going to do this on their own. I'm going to share a quote with you right now. It's a lengthy one. But one of the things that you hear a lot is you hear a lot of opinions about the religious beliefs of the founders. Again, you want to have people on the right who just say they were these dyed-in-the-wool, every single one of them was a Christian, God bless America. And then you want to have these others like, no, they were mostly deists. They were mostly people who didn't really think that God actually intervened in the affairs of men. He kind of wound up the whole universe and just let it go and then stepped back and is just letting it all happen. Let me read this quote. In 1787, about 11 years after the Declaration of Independence, Continental Congress came together to discuss a new constitution. The Articles of Confederation that they had put together in order for the nation to come together as the United States did not work. It was a mess. They were in debt. There was no central authority. It was just all over the place. And so they came together initially just to rewrite those articles to make it better, but eventually started to go, no, we just need to write something fully new. And in the middle of this, after weeks of angry fighting and bitter push back and forth and all of this stuff, someone stood up and said this: "Mr. President, the small progress that we have made after 4 or 5 weeks of close attendance and continual reasoning with each other, our different sentiments on almost every question, several of the last producing as many no's as ayes, it is absolute proof that the imperfection of human understanding is very real. We indeed seem to feel our own want of political wisdom, since we have been running about in search of it. We have gone back to ancient history for our models of government and examined the different forms of those republics which, having been formed with the seeds of their own disillusion, now no longer exist. We have viewed modern states all around Europe, but find none of their constitutions suitable to our circumstances. In this situation of this assembly, groping as if we were in the dark to find political truth, and scarce able to distinguish it when it is presented to us, how has it happened, sir, that we have not hitherto once thought of humbly applying to the Father of Lights to illuminate our understanding? In the beginning of the contest with Great Britain, we were sensible of the danger. We had daily prayer in this room for divine protection. Our prayers, sir, were heard, and they were graciously answered. All of us who were engaged in the struggle must have observed the frequent instances of a superintending providence that was in our favor. To that kind of providence, we owe this happy opportunity of consulting in peace on the means of establishing our future national government. And have we now forgotten that powerful friend? Or is it that we imagine that we no longer need his assistance? I have lived, sir, a long time. And the longer I live, the more convincing proofs I see of this truth, that God governs the affairs of men. If a sparrow cannot fall to the ground without his notice, it is probable that an entire empire cannot rise without his aid. I have been assured, sir, in the sacred writings, that except the Lord build a house, they labor in vain that build it. I firmly believe this, and I also believe that without his aid, we shall succeed in this political building no better than the builders of Babel. We shall be divided by our little partial local interests. Our projects will be confounded, and we ourselves shall become a reproach and a byword down to the future age. And what is worse, mankind may hereafter, from this unfortunate instance, despair of establishing a government by human wisdom and leave it to chance, war, and conquest. Therefore, I beg your leave to move this, that henceforth prayers imploring the assistance of heaven and its blessing on our deliberations be held in this assembly every morning before we proceed to business, and that one or more of the clergy of this city be requested to officiate in that service. Long quote, but worth hearing. Yes? Who said it? 81-year-old Dr. Benjamin Franklin at the Constitutional Convention, delivered on Thursday, June 28th, 1787, in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. That is not the language of a deist. And this was one of the least religious of our political fathers. Yet he understood that somehow God had intervened on their behalf. He didn't know why or how, but he understood that much. And this is what we ultimately come down to. If you want to look at our nation today, the infighting, the problems that we see, the back and forth, we have somehow managed to divorce ourselves from reliance on God. And I am not going to lay this at the feet of government. I'm not going to lay this at the feet of the world, because it belongs at our feet as the church. In times of great peril, our nation continues to draw back to that first thing of reliance on God. For those of us that lived through it, we saw it right after 9/11. Churches were packed with people praying and crying out, trying to figure out what was going on. We've seen it in moments in our lives. But then we get comfortable and it fades away. In his book, Six Months in the White House with Abraham Lincoln, Francis B. Carpenter wrote in 1867, just a few years after Lincoln's death, a particular account of President Lincoln right at the beginning of the war, where a clergy member came up to him and after giving him, you know, a very heartfelt congratulations on his presidency and you know, just kind of a hurrah, here we go to the war, he said to him, "And I believe God is on our side." It was not the thing you wanted to say to President Lincoln. Lincoln looked at him and said this, "I am not at all concerned about that. For I know that the Lord is always on the side of the right. But it is my constant anxiety and prayer that I and this nation should be on the Lord's side." We ask ourselves the wrong question. We don't ask ourselves, is God on our side? We ask ourselves, are we on his? So let me ask you this question. As we're gearing up for yet another presidential election, where are you placing your hope? I love this land. I love this country. I love the foundations that were set to get us to where we are. But as much as I love it, my hope is not in that flag, because that's something that can be taken away. And as I've said every time I'm behind this podium, if you have hope in anything you can lose, it's an idol. There's not a political figure who is going to save you or us. There's not a makeup of Congress that's going to make everything okay. There's not a particular system that if it just went more the way I think it should be, or if it just went more this way, that's going to fix this. Because our hope, my brothers and sisters in Christ, my hope is that you understand this. Our hope is in God alone. There's a dear man of God who I never got the had the good fortune to meet, named Dr. Michael S. Heiser. And he just died here recently of pancreatic cancer, but he was a Bible scholar, very, very wise man, really, really has been very formative for me in these past several years. And he addressed this issue, particularly over issues of technology and comfort, but also related to the idea of government and perfecting society as we so think we can do. And he said this, "The hunger for utopia, for perfection in whatever form it takes, shows us on the one hand that Paul is correct in Romans 1. There is a God-shaped void in every human heart. We are hardwired internally to want Eden again. But the problem is this, we want God out of it. And when you're discovering technologies of all sorts like we are, you begin to convince yourself that there is nothing you can't do. Think back to the Tower of Babel. And when you think that thought, when you think, well, everybody else has failed to bring utopia, but if you put me in charge, we'll pull it off. And that's the problem. We are mimicking the Creator with our creative power and prowess. And in that sense, we're doing what we were created to do. We're imaging God. But if you leave God out of the equation, the end goal of this always leads to more human misery every single time. I don't blame the world for being the world. I don't blame the world for having opinions that don't align with Christ. I don't hold them to that standard. You want to know why? They don't belong to Him. They're not following Him, and they're not claiming to. Why in the world would we look at them and say, you need to act like this, be like this, do this? When they have not had a transforming encounter with Jesus Christ. We want them to go back to the works and the dead things of the old covenant? Is that what we're telling them? That it's enough for you to go back to those dead things? However, I do have a problem with those of us who claim the name of Christ, who claim to be followers, looking like the world, acting like our reliance is completely on our political system or a certain person being in power or certain laws being enacted or not enacted, having this idea that if people just did it my way, it would be perfect, it would just bring this great, no. Here's the scripture part, and it's a long one, so here we go. And this is what this whole message, the title of this message is, Blessed is the Nation. Psalm 33, 10 through 22. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He frustrates the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, and the plans of His heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom He has chosen as His heritage. The Lord looks down from heaven and He sees all the children of men. From where he sits enthroned, he looks out on all the inhabitants on earth. He who fashions the heart of them all and observes all their deeds. The king is not saved by his great army. A warrior is not delivered by his great strength. The war horse is a false hope for salvation, and by its great might, it cannot rescue. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, that he may deliver their soul from death and keep them alive in famine. Our soul, whose soul? Those of us who believe. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield, for our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. Like I said before, I love this place. I love this church. I love Ohio. I love this country. If you ever want to have a political debate with me, I'm more than happy to share you my thoughts and my feelings. This is not the place for that. Do we believe what I just read? Do we believe that our hope is not in that, but in that? Do we actually live like it? Like I said, I love all the things. I love the fireworks and the parades and, you know, going to Washington and seeing these monuments and reading the quotes of these men. It'll bring a tear to my eye. It will. But if all of this is gone tomorrow, what will you do? Will you even know who you are? Our identity is found in the one who has purchased us from death, period. Full stop. There can be other things that come after that, other things we identify with, other things we love, other things we believe in, but that has to be first. Do you believe that what you believe is really real? As Franklin said, have you forgotten that powerful friend? I will tell you, the longer I've been in ministry, the more I know this. There's a lot I don't know. One of my favorite quotes that I've ever heard, one of the most theologically brilliant things I've ever heard, is from the movie Rudy, where he's sitting there with his priest. And at one point, he kind of looks at him and says, you know what? In all my years, there's two things I've learned. There is a God, and I'm not him. You guys, as believers, we're called to a standard beyond what culture dictates to us. We just are. That's what being a Christian, that's what being a follower means. And I'll tell you this, I am not gonna stand before God to answer for how I align with the current thing. I'm not. Or how I was respected by culture. The measure of holiness, the measure of what it looks like to be a follower, the measure of what it looks like to be a Christian American or Christian wherever you're from is him. He is who we go to. He is our standard. He is the one who leads us forward. Because if he is our Lord, as we claim, it means that we have a king. And if we have a king, it means that we follow at his pleasure, not at our own. And that means that no matter what the cultural wind and waves are, there are some things we do not get to have an opinion on. And I know we don't like that. Americans don't like that. We get opinions on everything. If we're truly under the lordship and headship of Christ, if we truly believe that what we read in Scripture is real, there are some things we do not get to have an opinion on. Do we as believers live like that? Do we talk like that when we get into discussions on the internet? Do we vote like that? And I'm not going to tell you who to vote for or what to vote for. But I am telling you the standard doesn't need to be how you feel. Does our allegiance to a greater kingdom, to our king, inform what we see as moral? Or have we looked at those things and said, no, this is political? Have we done what the founders did with slavery and said, no, this is political, this isn't a moral issue? I don't have to put the Bible over that. I don't have to put my Christianity over top of that. I don't have to let the Lord lead me in that. This is just politics. God, help us all. I don't know where you're at with some of these things I've shared today. Like I said, I know I've offended some people, and that's fine. My hope is that I've offended most of you a little, as opposed to a few of you a lot. We're gonna do a little worshiping here for a bit. Team's coming out. I want us all to stand. I know this one's gonna have to sit with you a while. You're gonna have to do some thinking about it, but I wanna encourage you. Think about it. Pray about it. Ask yourself that question. What am I most allegiant to? Who am I most allegiant to? Have I forgotten that powerful friend? In the midst of all of our political and social craziness and angst, have I forgotten that I'm a Christian first?